Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the online presentation of the 2021 New South Wales Premier's History Awards. My name is George Souris, and I am the President of the Library Council of New South Wales. We are so glad you've taken the time to join us this evening, wherever you may be. We would have, of course, much preferred to welcome you in person to the library, but sadly, that could not be. Nonetheless, it is still a great pleasure to be able to address you in this virtual ceremony to acknowledge these important awards. Firstly, I do acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land upon which this broadcast is coming to you, and I acknowledge also the traditional custodians of the lands upon which the Public Library Network of New South Wales, all 362 public libraries, stand. The New South Wales Premier's History Awards are presented by the New South Wales Government and administered by the State Library of New South Wales, the principal custodian of heritage and history in this state, in association with Create New South Wales and with the support of the History Council of New South Wales. On behalf of the Library, I would like to extend a special thanks to the Premier of New South Wales, the Honourable Gladys Berejiklian, and the Minister for the Arts, the Honourable Don Harwin, for their support of these awards. We now have a message from the Premier of New South Wales, the Honourable Gladys Berejiklian, MP.
Welcome to this year's New South Wales Premier's History Awards and the official launch of History Week 2021. These events celebrate the important work of Australian historians who hold up a mirror to the past so we can better understand ourselves as people and as a nation. I congratulate all the finalists and winners in this year's award categories. Now more than ever before, these awards have particular significance. What does our past tell us about the resilience we have to deal with the challenges before us today? This year's History Week theme is From Ground Up, which reminds us of the special relationship that Australia and First Australians in particular have with the land. It also recognises that history occurs all around us all of the time, shaped by each and every one of us. Our past actions inform our present, and our actions today will influence our future. I'm confident when historians look back at this period of time, they will celebrate our people's courage, resilience, and sacrifice. I commend the State Library for coordinating these awards and the judges for their time and expertise in assessing all the entries. Thanks to the History Council of New South Wales for your continued advocacy for history in New South Wales. Once again, my congratulations to all the winning historians and those shortlisted for this year's awards. There is no doubt your work will endure for generations to come.
Thank you, Premier. We're also grateful for the continuing support of the Minister for the Arts, the Honourable Don Harwin, who has been the custodian and leader of a golden era in not only the State Library, but the Public Library Network of New South Wales. It's with great pleasure now that I invite the Honourable Don Harwin, MLC, to address us.
Good evening, how are you? I'd like to start by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which I'm joining you tonight. I'd like to pay my respects to the elders past and present and thank them for their extraordinary custodianship of this very beautiful place. Well, the New South Wales Government through Create New South Wales is once again extremely proud to be the sponsor of this year's New South Wales Premier's History Prize. It is really, really disappointing that we can't all be together to celebrate the wonderful efforts of all the people who are involved in writing books for tonight's awards. Their work's fantastic. History really matters. How we remember our past directly influences how we shape our future. And as we live through constantly evolving times, it's never been more important to have historians recording it. Not just for us, but also, very importantly, for readers, historians, researchers in the future. So I just want to congratulate all the finalists for their excellent contribution to our history, to telling our stories, to making Australia a better place. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Minister. And now I would like to welcome our most excellent State Librarian, Dr. John Valance.
Thanks very much, George. Now I'd like to thank the judges for this year's History Awards. The senior judge in 2021 is Dr. Matthew Allen, and his fellow judges were Dr. Lawrence Bamblett, Associate Professor Anna Clark, Professor Kate Fulliger, Dr. Noel Januszewska, Dr. Andy Kaladelfos, Associate Professor Julia Martinez, and Professor Heidi Norman. Our warmest thanks to all of you. Now, in the interests of a little variety, this year I've asked my colleague, the Mitchell Librarian at the State Library of New South Wales, Richard Neville, if he'd take us through the list of winners. So I'll hand over to Richard now.
Thanks, John. It's my pleasure to take you through the announcements of the awards themselves. Before we get to those announcements, we are going to hear the New South Wales Premier's History Award address. This year, the address will be given to us by Professor Kate Fulliger. Kate is the Professor of History at the Institute for the Humanities and the Social Sciences at the Australian Catholic University. Her most recent book, The Warrior, the Voyager and the Artist, won the General History Prize in the 2020 History Awards, and this year at the Premier's Literary Awards won the General Non-Fiction Prize. Kate is also the lead chief investigator on an ARC linkage project with the National Portrait Gallery called Facing New Worlds. Kate is also the editor, the co-editor of the Australian Historical Association's journal, History Australia. Kate will be talking to us about history from the ground up. Thanks, Kate.
Good evening, everybody. It is lovely to be with you all virtually tonight. Although, of course, it would have been much better to be together in person after more than a year of this awful pandemic. As ever, I take my hat off to the library staff for transitioning yet another physical event to the ethereal. Let's begin tonight with an acknowledgement of the lands that we are all standing on this evening. I want to acknowledge Cadigal land on which the library stands, and I also want to acknowledge Ngunnawal land upon which I am standing this evening. The theme of land is in fact perfect for the launch of this year's History Week theme, History from the Ground Up. Nothing, after all, could speak more directly to this notion of history both emerging from the ground and being grounded in place than an acknowledgement of country. I note that one third of the 15 shortlisted works this year for the Library's History Awards deals explicitly with this issue of land. We have land that shakes in Japan, as discussed by Janet Borland. We've got land formed by violence in both Australia and Spain, as analysed by Luke Stigman. Matthew Koloff explores land that belongs and land that doesn't. Grace Karskens tells us about the land around rivers. And Luke Keogh, his book is about the bits of land that you can carry in a case. The moment of what is otherwise known as environmental history, it seems, has well and truly arrived. And frankly, not before time. For all that environmental history seems like an obvious theme for our dangerously warming times, it's also a logical outcome of the now decades-old Western turn towards lower or grittier perspectives. That turn emerged in the post-war world in the aftermath of a crisis that changed forever the stability of elites and of gender norms. From the 1960s especially, the baby boom generation sought to produce histories that matched or explained fresh interests in the power of ordinary people on the ground, and in particular in the power of women. These were called social histories and feminist histories. The causes of social history and feminist history are clearly not over. Several shortlisted works this year show how much they continue to be important and needed. We've got the history of working class Catholics in The Altar Boys, and the history of trackside bookies in On a Winner. There's the history of missionary nuns in A Bridge Between, and the history of female union activists in Women of Steel. These works reveal the influence of those from below in shaping the world we live in today, a world still too often thought to be the result only of the powerful from above. Out of those initial movements to review history from the ground up came the confidence to investigate other groups that had been traditionally overlooked. From the 1980s, we saw the serious growth of gay or queer history. That subfield is beautifully represented tonight by the exhibition Small Town Queer from Tweed Regional Museum. From the 1990s, focus shifted for some to the perspective and agency of children in the making of the past. Histories of children have been slower to take their place in contemporary historical practice, but this year's contenders show that they have now surely come of age. Borland's exploration of a Tokyo earthquake highlights the role of children. Suzanne Smith's expose of a Newcastle Catholic church also places kids front and centre. The Young People's category in the Library Awards, of course, exemplifies this subfield especially well. Lorraine Marwood provides an unusual angle on the Vietnam War by viewing it through the eyes of a child, while The Friendly Games shines light on the case of young John Wing, who altered Olympic protocols forever. Children's history provides a new ways of thinking about events that we thought we knew all about, sometimes literally from a couple of feet lower down than normal. Now, the advance of Indigenous history was not a further outgrowth of post-war movements, but rather something that developed steadily, if quietly, alongside them. It was influenced far more by the decolonising trends of the era than by the experience of world crisis. Histories of the people most connected to the grounds on which they stand have been trying to reshape national histories for decades. This year's shortlist suggests they may finally be making gains. More than one third of the titles this year centre Indigenous subjects. The biographies of Kathy Freeman and Archie Roach in particular demonstrate how an Indigenous focus can challenge and push the very genre in which they appear. Interestingly too, though perhaps not surprisingly, most of the titles that I mentioned before in relation to land also have a strong Indigenous theme. I think the only shortlisted work that I've not alluded to so far is Michael Bennett's War Against Smallpox, which is admittedly more about scientists than about ordinary folk and takes a global view rather than a grounded one. All the same though, what could be more resonant of our grounded experience of the last 20 months than a history of how everyday people, through their consent to be vaccinated, managed truly to change the world? I was absolutely delighted to be a judge for two of the categories awarded here tonight, the general category and the digital category. I enjoyed learning, however, about entrants in all five categories. Together, I think these entrants show that they are a testament to the vitality of history making in Australia in this moment, a vitality that stems from over two generations now of historical practice trying to reimagine the past from the ground up. My sincere congratulations to all those represented today. I personally know that not everyone who should have been recognised could have been recognised. There are only three per category. But I do hope that everyone at home can enjoy consuming all these grounded and grounding histories. I hope you also get a chance to take in other events in the History Week calendar. Keep safe, everyone, until we meet again in person in the library.
Thanks, Kate, for that stimulating and thoughtful address. Now we move on to the award proceedings themselves. If you're going to tweet this event, please use the hashtag NewSouthWalesPHA, and I think you can see that on your screen. Each award tonight is worth $15,000. Across all categories, the total prize money being offered is $75,000. The first prize tonight is a Digital History Award, which is given to for the interpretation of an historical subject using non-print media. Now, the shortlist for the 2021 Digital History Prize is Women of Steel by Robin Murphy and Martha and Sarah, and it was produced by Jobs for Women Film Producers Group. Second on the shortlist is Freeman by Laurence Billet, General Strike and Matchbox Pictures. And the third is Small Town Queer Online Exhibition and Collection Project by the Tweed Regional Museum. And the winner is Freeman by Laurence Billet. The judges noted Freeman is a model of how digital media can enhance historical understanding. its sensitive combination of testimony, hindsight, analytical reflection, and contemporary representation conjures up the past on multiple scales.
Thank you so much. It's an honour to receive this Digital History Awards. So, of course, a big thank you to the New South Wales Premier, to the whole team at the State Library, to the jury, and my best wishes to the other two excellent nominees, Women of Steel and Small Town Queer. My warmest thanks go to the ABC, and in particular to Joe Chichester, who commissioned the film, and Helen Pankhurst at Matchbox Pictures, who believed in this project from the word go and made it happen. The film wouldn't be what it is without Stephen Page and his brilliant team at Bangarra Dance Theatre, who brought to life on screen the spirituality of Cathy Freeman as she prepares to compete on the greatest stage on earth. We made Freeman during the Melbourne lockdown. I'm not sure if it was the first one or the second one or the third one. I've lost track. So, of course, I'd like to thank my family, Rachel and Emil. We very much made this film together. Cathy's race is arguably one of the greatest collective experiences in Australia's modern history. And I was always fascinated by it, you know, like, what the hell happened? So I'm really grateful to Cathy Freeman for sharing her story and for her trust. In those 49 incredible seconds, not only did she win a gold medal, but I think she also rewrote history and changed the narrative and offered a new possibility for the relationship between Indigenous and non-Indigenous Australians. And in many ways, it's a moment that changed us all. So I'm hoping that the film will be seen by people who were not born in 2000, and that it will inspire us to continue to fight for gender and racial equality. Thank you very much.
The next category is the Young People's History Prize. This prize is for a work that increases an understanding and appreciation of history amongst children and young adults. The shortlist for this award is The Friendly Games by Kay Bailey and Fiona Burrows, Midnight Sun Publishing, Footprints on the Moon by Lorraine Marwood, University of Queensland Press, and Tell Me Why for Young Adults by Archie Roach. And that's Simon & Schuster, Australia. And the winner is Tell Me Why for Young Adults by Archie Roach. Now, the judges commented that Tell Me Why is a gracious and honest first-person account of the life of Roach, one of Australia's most acclaimed musicians. We are invited into Roach's life, his childhood, where memories are fragmented images, reconnecting with family, finding love, becoming a father, an elder, and an acclaimed storyteller.
Hey, this is Archie Roach, and I'd like to thank the New South Wales Premier's History Prize for Young People. What a great honour. And also my publishers, Simon & Schuster, and people who worked on the book, like Erica Wagner, Jill Shelton, my manager, Culture is Life, and Ben McElvay. Also the young people and elders who contributed their voices to this book as well. And last but not least, the other finalists in this category. Thank you all so much. What a great honour.
The next category is the New South Wales Community and Regional History Prize. This prize is for a work that makes a significant contribution to the understanding of community, institutional, urban and regional history in New South Wales. The shortlist for the New South Wales Community and Regional History Prize is Landscapes of Our Hearts, Reconciling People and Environments by Matthew Colliffe, published by Thames and Hudson Australia. Honour winner, 125 Years of City Tattersalls Club by Maria Donnelly, Wilkinson Publishing, and The Altar Boys by Suzanne Smith, ABC Books, an imprint of HarperCollins Publishers. And the This year's winner is Landscapes of Our Hearts, Reconciling People and Environment by Matthew Colliff. The judges commented that Landscapes of Our Hearts digs deep to ask big, important questions and resists simplistic answers. The writing is sophisticated and accomplished. It moves confidently across the domains of science and culture.
I thank the State Library of New South Wales and the judging panel for this award for Landscapes of Our Hearts. I'm honoured and deeply grateful. I thank the incredible team at Thames and Hudson, Australia, for their encouragement, support and professionalism, particularly the exceptional work of Sally Heath and Elise Hassett. My partner Alison Killen told me stories of the landscapes of her heart, endured my long periods of isolation, and provided valuable comments on the draft. Landscapes of Our Hearts is not a conventional history. I came to Australia as an adult migrant from the UK, and the book is my attempt to make sense of this extraordinary continent, but also in telling stories of how others came to terms with its landscapes, how people made their impact on place, and how in turn place affected them. Telling these stories is my way of giving back to country. I explore the unfolding triangle of relationships between Indigenous and non-Indigenous Australians and the land, which has been in existence, evolving and changing, since the convicts, marines, seamen and civil servants of the First Fleet disembarked over 230 years ago. This triangle has shaped our common history and was central to the conflict of the colonial era. It was at the heart of the Mabo and Wick decisions as defining acts of change in the 20th century. It continues today in how we negotiate and reframe our relationships with country. How we shape those relationships with land and to each other is fundamental to our future and the processes of conciliation, truth-telling, and finding pathways to self-determination for First Nations peoples. By walking together, we can build a different and better nation for all Australians.
The next prize is the General History Prize. This is an award for a major work of international history which has national or international significance. And the shortlist for the 2021 General History Prize is War Against Smallpox, Edward Jenner and the Global Spread of Vaccinations by Michael Bennett, Cambridge University Press. Earthquake Children, Building Resilience from the Ruins of Tokyo by Jeanette Borland, Harvard University Asia Centre. The Wardian Case, How a Simple Box Moved Plants and Changed the World by Luke Keogh, the University of Chicago Press and Q Publishing. And this year the winner is The Wardian Case, How a Simple Box Moved Plants and Changed the World by Luke Keogh. The judges commented that Keogh brings a curator's eye to produce a distilled history of one object, but it's so much more than that. The Wardian Case is a story of colonial ambition as well as scientific invention.
Hello, I'm Luke, the author of The Wardian Case. Thank you so much to the New South Wales Premier's History Awards for this very important award. It is quite humbling, and thank you to all of the people at the State Library of New South Wales who have administered the award and the committee and the selection committee and those people involved. The Wardian Case is an interesting topic for a book. In 1829, the London doctor Nathaniel Bagshaw Ward discovered that plants enclosed in airtight glass cases can survive for long periods of time without water. A few years later, Ward decided to test his invention for long-distance plant transportation, and he sent it on the longest voyage then known, to Sydney. And those plants that arrived in Sydney from London survived this journey, and they survived the return journey. What was fascinating is that the next century of using Wardian cases for moving plants all over the globe had huge consequences. Some were good, and some were not so good. My book covers much of this topic. A very big thank you to the people who believed in the book, the research organisations that helped to fund some of the research in various locations around the globe. A large thank you to my publishers, University of Chicago Press and to Q Publishing. And a very special thank you to the Wardian Case in the commissioning editor's house. So it was very fortunate for a first-time author that she knew what her Wardian Case actually was. But a very large thank you to everyone who has supported me along the journey, in particular to my family, who have travelled to many places with me and who have kept me smiling the whole way. Thank you so much for the award. It means such a great deal.
And now we come to the final award for tonight, which is the Australian History Prize. The Australian History Prize is for a major work which addresses subjects of national Australian significance. And the shortlist for the 2021 Australian History Prize is People of the River, Lost Worlds of Early Australia by Grace Carskins, Alan and Unwin, A Bridge Between, Spanish Benedictine Missionary Women in Australia by Catherine Massam, ANU Press, and Amnesia Road, Landscapes, Violence and Memory by Luke Stegman, New South Wales Publishing. And the winner is People of the River, Lost Worlds of Early Australia by Grace Carskins. The judges commented that People of the River is an impressive reflection on the pivotal place river landscapes played in the early Australian history of Australia. Carskins tells her story from a range of perspectives as she explores the way that different groups of people make their own mark on a river and surrounding landscape.
Hello, I'm speaking to you from Kari Country on the beautiful New South Wales Central Coast. And I want to first acknowledge the traditional owners of this land, the Gurungai and the Dakanyong people, and pay my respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging. Wow. Well, I'm absolutely thrilled to be awarded the New South Wales Premier's Award for Australian History, and stunned, really, to be chosen from a short list of such compelling and wonderful books. I really want to pay tribute to all the shortlisted authors this evening. Congratulations. Well, I think as many of you here tonight will know, writing is something you wrestle with. It's something that possesses you utterly. It's exhilarating, it's terrifying. People of the River absolutely obsessed me and had me entranced for at least a decade. So I think this is a win for slow history. But take the history that, you know, you need to take the time to explore and unravel and recover forgotten histories, the histories of the people who were left out of mainstream history. So this is also a win for regional and environmental history, because this is the scale where intimate stories of peoples and rivers and plants and animals can be told. It's also, I think, the place where the larger historical themes can be read on the ground. So the larger themes such as the practices and politics of empire, which play such an important role in modern Australian history. So you can see how they play out, but also how sometimes they were absolutely subverted. And finally, you know, regional history is the scale at which truth-telling about Australian history, as proposed by the Uluru Statement from the Heart, can properly take place. So, heartfelt thanks to the Premier and the people of New South Wales for honouring history and historians in this way. And I also want to thank the judges for their time and expertise and consideration. That must have been a hell of a job. And also thanks to John Valance and the wonderful people at the State Library of New South Wales, our precious and beloved library. I have to thank some extraordinary people. First and foremost, my publishers, Alan and Unwin, and especially Elizabeth Feese. Elizabeth, among many other things, is dedicated to publishing scholarly Aboriginal history. She backed this book. She believed in it. She even actually rescued it when an earlier publisher wanted to charge me $17,000 to publish it. People of the River was also birthed with the help and patience of countless colleagues and friends and unsuspecting experts. You know who you are. Thank you so much. And of course, I had the unstinting support of my institution, the University of New South Wales, Sydney. Richard Waterhouse once more has shared this long journey with me and providing love and encouragement and endless chapter readings and also the most wonderful meals. And out of this book evolved another amazing collaborative project, The Real Secret River, Jerubbin, which is based on a long-lost list of Aboriginal names for the Hawkesbury River. Heartfelt thanks to Rob Thomas and the State Library of New South Wales for making that project possible. And thank you to Darug women Leanne Watson, Erin Wilkins, Rhiannon Wright, and Jasmine Seymour, and Darkinyung woman Cindy Laws, as well as many other experts who volunteered their time and have since, all of you have since become dear friends. Together we put over 90 Aboriginal place names back on the map and recovered a lot of Darug and Darkinyung Jerubbin, geography, history, and sacred landscapes. My last book, The Colony, was dedicated to my parents, Bill and Francine Karskens. They both arrived in Australia in the 1950s. They met here, married, made a family. Ordinary, extraordinary story. People of the River is dedicated to a new generation, their beautiful great-grandchildren, Yanni, Ophelia, and Frankie Lee. Little ones, how they would have loved you. Thank you all for being here tonight and sharing this special celebration of history and fellowship. We're on our screens, as we must be. We're apart, but we're together in spirit, and that's what matters. Good night.
Tonight has been a celebration for the diversity of the practice of history and to the importance of history in helping us make sense of our lives. A huge congratulations to both our shortlisted authors and, of course, to the winners themselves. I would now like to hand back to John, who will conclude the proceedings.
Thank you very much, Richard, and my warmest congratulations, of course, to all the winners and the shortlisted authors this year. George Souris and I, in closing, would like to thank the Premier and the Minister once again for their support of these important awards, our judging panel, and it remains for me, and in a sense this is the most important thing of all, to encourage all of you to go out and buy this year's books, read them, and see if you agree with the judges' judgments. The Premier's History Awards traditionally marks the beginning of History Week in New South Wales, which is organised by the New South Wales History Council. And the theme of this year's History Week is From the Ground Up. As one member put it, this is to encourage stories from the street, stories from the soil that provide the material and the momentum for the making of history. It's a reminder, really, that if we want to understand who we are, where we've come from, understand the richness of the communities that make up our society, we have to go back constantly to first principles, go right and build our accounts of who we are from the ground up. So all the very best to everybody involved in History Week this year. My warmest congratulations once again to the winner, and fingers crossed that I can start welcoming all of you back in person to the State Library of New South Wales. Thank you for joining us this year.